Every mantra is commented, explanations are given. Mainly the tone of the mantras, almost every word of all mantras in Rig Veda is commented. Tone also is given.
Dr. Amitji, apart from Sayana Bhashya, what are the other earlier commentaries of Rig Veda?
Sayanacharya's commentary is very well known regarding Rig Veda. Not only Rig Veda, he had commented all the Vedas, including Brahmanas, Aranyakas and Upanishads. And there is one Bhatta Bhaskaracharya who also commented Rig Veda, mainly focusing on Vyakarana Niyamas, Vyakarana injunctions and their implications in the Rig Veda, usage of Vyakarana. And then Skanda Swami, he was also a very great commentator. Venkata Madhava, Udgita, Mudgala, so on and so forth. These are all the commentators of Rig Veda.
How is this commentary different from the earlier commentaries?
All those commentaries which I mentioned before, they all show the ritualistic meaning of the Vedic literature, which is very essential, very important. Vedic rituals are extremely important in our life. Shrauta Sutra talks on the implications of applications of mantras in rituals. Brahmana portions also talk on that. Based on Brahmana literature, based on Shrauta Sutra, these great souls, commentators like Sayana or Bhatta Bhaskara, they commented. Their commentary is a ritual based commentary, and all mantras are seen, perceived from the context of rituals, Vedic rituals. But here what we do is seeing the Vedic mantras in a spiritual point of view, in a yogic point of view, in adhyatmika point of view. That is the speciality of our commentary. Here, in a spiritual way, in a psychological way, we take every mantra and comment the mantras of the Rig Veda.
Very interesting. Has anyone before you written a commentary based on adhyatmika basis, basically esoteric or a spiritual basis, Dr. Amitji?
Yes. There were so many commentators. Adhyatmika base of the Veda is found in the Veda itself. If the meaning of a word in the Veda cannot be understood, a meaning can be found from some other place in the same Veda. So there we see spiritual purport, spiritual heart of the Veda. Then in some places in Brahmana portions also, spiritualistic perception, spiritualistic view is there to the Vedic mantras. And in Niruktam, Nirukta is a very ancient text, probably older than Mahabharata, because in Mahabharata, Niruktakara's name is mentioned, Nirukta's author's name, Yaska. Yaska Maharshi, and Nirukta Shastra also is mentioned. Nirukta perceives the Veda. There are references in Nirukta Shastra to perceive the Veda in a spiritual way. For example, Yaska, the author of Nirukta, says, Mahabhagyat Devatayaha Yeka Atma Bhagudha Stuyate. One Atman is there, and this Atman is extolled in many ways. Ekasya Atmanaha Anye Devaha Pratyangani Bhavanti. all devas are limbs for this one Atman. All devas are parts of that one Atman. Atmaiva esham rataha bhavati atma ashvaha atma ayudham atma ishavaha atma sarvam devasya devasya. Atman is a chariot of devas, Atman is ashva, horse, Atman is weapon, Atman is shafts. Everything for every deva is Atman. This is what Vyaska says. This is a spiritual perception of Vyaskacharya. In Ramayana too, we see this is a spiritual way of seeing devatas. Let me give an example here. Sri Rama, on seeing the beautiful Chitrakuta mountain, says to Sita Devi, Idameva Amrutam Prahuhu Ragi Rajarshayav Pare Vanavasam Bhavartaya Pretyame Prapita Mahaha. This natural beauty is ambrosia. Idameva Amrutam Prahuhu. This is how our ancestors had found. Vanavasa is ambrosia, he says. Ambrosia or amruta or soma is a juice extracted from some creeper. This is the external meaning of soma or amruta. But here we see the internal meaning. Even the aesthetic sense which flows from the depth of our heart towards the natural beauty, or the aesthetic sense in general towards our life itself, can be taken as soma. Likewise, Ramayana perceives different devatas in esoteric sense in some places. Mahabharata also follows the same course. The very well-known Bhagavad Gita of Mahabharata talks on yajna in esoteric sense only. The celebrated Lord Sri Krishna, yajnartha karmanonyatra, while talking karma yoga, he identifies this karma yoga with the concept of yajna and gives an esoteric meaning for yajna, which was already found in the Rigveda. So, there are so many contexts in which Mahabharata perceives the Vedic devatas in an esoteric sense. Coming to Puranas, Puranas 2 do that. The fifth book of Bhagavatam. There you can see a whole chapter is dedicated for exploring the esoteric meaning of the terms like Soma, Vayu, Varuna, Agni, and so on. Coming to Acharyas, Shankara Bhagavatpada, he sees in some places the Vedic mantras in esoteric sense. A very well-known mantra in Rigveda, Aranyor Nihito Jata Vedaha Garbhaiva Subhruto Garbhadibhi. The same mantra is coming in Katha Upanishad also. There Shankaracharya interprets this mantra in two ways. One in exoteric way, another one in esoteric way. So both interpretations he gives for this mantra. It's clear that mantras of the Veda can be seen in two ways. Aranyor Nihito Jata Vedaha. One, he describes a ritual fire, that is exoteric way of seeing that. Another one, he sees that same ritual fire as Atman. Here the whole mantra is taken for Atman too. In the commentary of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Shankaracharya is talking about devas and asuras. Devasuras che pranaha vagadayaha. Devas and asuras are nothing but our own senses. Shastra janita jnana karma bharitaha devaha. When the senses are attuned to knowledge and ritual, action that are born of scriptures, that are born of Shastra, then these senses can be called as devas. Tayeva swabhavika pratyaksha anumana janita drishta prayojana karma jnana bhavitaha asudaha. The same senses, when they narrow themselves only to the materialistic perception, then they become asuras, Shankaracharya says. Sri Ramanujacharya perceives always yajna as Bhagavad Aradhanam only. In his great scriptures, texts like Nityam or Vedartha Sangraha and then Bhagavad Gita Bhashya, Sri Bhashya, everywhere, the whole of yajna is perceived as Bhagavad Aradhana. He takes yajna only in esoteric sense, mainly in esoteric sense. And then Madhvacharya, regarding Madhvacharya, he himself is a commentator of Rigveda. It's a very important thing. Even before Sayanacharya, he commented on Rigveda, but in a very spiritual way. He gives esoteric and spiritual explanations for the several mantras of Rigveda in a beautiful way. For example, Ime somaha arankritaha. These somas are prepared for you. There, Madhvacharya describes, Bhaktya hyalankrita soma manamsi. Here, somas are minds. Arankritaha, here alankritaha, they are decorated with the sattvic feelings like devotion. This is how he gives esoteric explanations. The whole of Rigveda commentary of Madhvacharya is based on spirituality only. Yatha agnyadayaha shabdaha pravartante janardane tatha niruttim vakshyamaha jnaninam jnanasiddhaye. The epithets like Agni, Varuna, Vayu, they all belong to Paramatman, the Supreme Soul, that is Vishnu. I establish in this commentary in this way, says Madhvacharya. So, next, in the commentaries of Sayanacharya or Bhattabhaskara or Skandaswami, in all these great commentators, we see here and there some spiritual hints. Spiritual perception of Vedic mantras are there. For example, Naya Ishante, in this mantra, Sayanacharya describes Maruts as vitals. Marutam pranarupena avastham. That's how Sayanacharya describes Maruts. Evanunam is a mantra. In that mantra, while Sayana describes or interprets the word Suridvamsam, he says, Antrayamitvat Sushtu Sarvam Janantam Evamvidam Indram. As Indra is the indweller within us, he knows everything, he says. Likewise, Sayana is describing all devas as indwellers. Sayana also opens the knots in the Rigveda, which are there in the form of symbolism. Rathaya Navam is a mantra. In that mantra Sayana comments the water as samsara flow, in which an entity is falling. At the time to uplift him, boat is coming. This boat is a symbol of the movement which can uplift a being. This is what Sayana comments. Therefore, Rathaya Bhavam in this mantra. Isheyo Vishwasya. In this mantra, Sayanacharya comments Ratha, chariot, as movement, which can be for our progressive spiritual journey. Pivanam Mesham. This is another mantra. where Sayanacharya clearly says, while explaining Apsu Antaha, he says, water in the Veda is a symbol of the fundamental energy flow found in unmanifest nature. Prakritisthanam Sukshmanam, this is what Sayanacharya says. In another mantra, starting from Hiranya Rupam Ushasaha Vishtav, Sayana comments Aditi as generic and Diti as particular. Aditim Akhandaniyam Bhumim, Ditim Prajadikam. Okay. There is another mantra which starts from Dharma Samanta. There Sayanacharya clearly gives two meanings. Exotic meaning runs in this way. It shows Agni and Surya. Esoteric meaning Jivatman and Paramatman, individual and infinite soul. In this way, Sayanacharya perceives several mantras in esoteric sense. But overall, Sayanacharya gives ritualistic interpretation only, even though this spiritual insight Sayanacharya offers to us in several mantras in the Rig Veda. The same is with Bhattabhaskara, Skanda Swami. In some places they reveal the secret, they reveal the Ninyavachamsi, the esoteric purport of the Veda. And after all these great souls, in modern days, Swami Dayanand, he wrote a commentary for Rig Veda, where again he says all epithets found in the Veda, many dictions found in the Veda, denote the ultimate divine Paramatman. Therefore, the Rig Veda is spiritual. He interprets in this way only. Of course, even before Swami Dayanand, Bhakti tradition also has a word to say about, an important word to say about the Veda. Bhagavan Nama Bodhendra Swamigal, he wrote a great text called Bhagavan Nama Amrita Rasodaya. There he shows how the Veda is a Bhakti Shastra and how the glory of the divine name of Bhagavan is found in the Veda. Nama Mahima, Nama Mahatmyam is found in the Veda. He quotes several mantras for that, but some Mimamsakas, not all Mimamsakas, some Mimamsakas with the fundamentalistic attitude, they were alarmed. They were shocked on seeing this commentary of Bhagavan Nama Bodhendra. How dare you use the Veda for this Bhagavan Nama Mahatmya? Veda is only for ritualistic implications. Veda doesn't have any other purpose at all. You can't use these Vedic mantras for Nama chanting and all, for Bhakti and all. You can't see all those things in the Veda. You can't interpret the Veda in this way. This is a blasphemy. This is how they dared to approach Bhagavan Nama Bodhendra. At that time, to defend this concept, what Bhagavan Nama Bodhendra offered, Sridhara Swamigal, Sridhara Ayyavar, he wrote a wonderful book, Bhagavan Nama Bhushanam. This book was recently also published by Sri Sri Anna. This Bhagavan Nama Bhushanam is a very nice book, which clearly shows how the Veda can be seen in different dimensions. It is not necessity that Vedas have to be always seen in ritualistic view, even though ritualistic approach also is correct. That kind of fanatic outlook should not come regarding the Veda. Veda is a repository of knowledge. Even the very word Veda means knowledge. The word Veda doesn't mean karma. Right? Vidya jnane. Veda means jnana, knowledge. Though karma is important and karma way of interpretation also is there for the Veda. But so many abundant things are there in the Veda which have to be tapped. So many human values are there. And it is a repository of knowledge, Atma Vidya, Yoga Vidya. Such a spiritual wisdom, that is why we are calling the Veda as the mother of all schools of thoughts found in Sanatana Dharma. If it is just a ritual manual, we will not call like that. Mm-hmm. It has all these things. It is a seed of Ayurveda, it is a seed of Jyotisha. The Veda is a seed of Advaita, Advaita, Vishishta Advaita. The Veda is a seed of Vedanta, Yoga, Sankhya and all. We all accept that. If the Veda is a seed of all these schools of thoughts and darshanas and siddhantas, it's not just a lip service. If this is true, if this statement is true, that the Veda is the mother of all these things, then we have, it should be something more. It must be the repository of insights which got expanded as darshanas, siddhantas and so on. So, how in different dimensions Vedas can be seen, Vedic purport can be understood, and it is not always essential that it should be seen in a ritualistic way only. Even according to the great Mimamsakas, this demand is not always there. This is the understanding of Sridharaiya. He is establishing this in his book Bhagavan Nama Bhushanam, very wonderful book, a small book but very deep, pregnant with meaning. And these are all the foundations, Bhagavan Nama Bhushanam, Bhagavan Nama Amrita Rasodaya. In these texts we can see how Nama Mahatmya is formed. Even before that, a text of Lakshmidhara, all these things are showing how Bhagavan Nama, Nama Mahatmya and Bhakti, they are found in the Vedic literature. After all these books, our Sri Sri Anna's great contribution, Veda Vijnanam, has around some 100 articles, every great book. There we can see a detailed description, a thesis, how the whole of Bhakti is found in the Vedic literature. Take for example, Sadhana Bhakti. Sravana, Kirtana, Smarana, so on and so forth. Listening to the Leelas of Bhagavan and singing the glory of the Lord, remembrance of Bhagavan, all these things, this Sadhana Bhakti, Sravana, Kirtana, Smarana, all these things can be found in the Veda. Bhava Bhakti, Vatsalya, Sakya, Madhurya, such a kind of Bhava Bhakti is found in the Veda. Very beautiful things are there in Veda Vijnana. For Bhava Bhakti, Sri Sri Anna is taking a mantra. We all are familiar with the Bhagavata Shloka. Very famous Bhagavata Shloka. Ajata Pachayiva Mataram Khagaha Stanyam Yata Vatsataraha Chudartaha Priyam Priyeva Vishitam Vishanna Manaha Aravindaksha Didrikshate Twam. O Lotus Eyed Lord, I am waiting for you. I am keen to see you. Like the wingless little ones which are waiting for the mother bird, like the calves which are waiting for mother cow, like a beloved waiting for a lover. That is how the shloka goes. This is Bhava Bhakti, Madhurya and Vatsalya. Sri Sri Anna says in Veda Vijnanam, this shloka has its root in the Rig Veda. There is a mantra in Rig Veda, Gavaiva Gramam Yudhi Divashwana Vasreva Vatsam Supana Dugana पतिरिव जायाम अभिनोन्येतु धर्ता दिवहा सविता विश्ववारः वस्रेव वत्सम सेम वर्ड इज देयर इन भागवत वस्रेव वत्सकम अनुग्रहकात्रोस्मा वस्रेव वत्सम सुमना दुहाना लाइक द मदर काउ इज रशिंग टुवर्ड्स द काफ टू मिल्क लाइक द हस्बैंड इज रशिंग टुवर्ड्स हिज वाइफ आफ्टर अ लॉन्ग जर्नी May the divine come to us. This is what the Veda says, from which this Bhagavata Shloka has come. The connection Sri Anna is establishing in Veda Vijnana is just as sad. So many things are there in Veda Vijnana. How Bhava Bhakti streams are found in the Veda, Sri Anna shows in the Veda Vijnana. And after that, how Satya Bhakti, the ultimate devotion to the divine, ultimate love to divine, that is found in the Rig Veda, that is also showed in Veda Vijnana. And then what? How avataras are there in the Veda? Vrukshitikum sujani ma chakare, Trivikrama avatara. Like that, avataras are found in the Veda, that also is described in Veda Vijnana. In this way, the Veda is seen in spiritual light. Okay, this is Bhakti tradition. Let me come back to that point. Madhvacharya saw all Devata Namas as the Antaryamins Namas. That's how this Madhvacharya's approach. Dayanand's approach also was like that. And then came Sri Aurobindo, his thesis, Secret of the Veda, Hymns on Mystic Fire, Savitri, Life, the Life Divine. These are the books written by Sri Aurobindo regarding the Vedic literature. There again he approached the Veda in a spiritual way. He started to give psychological interpretations of the Veda. It was flowing one after the other for every god of the Veda. To the Vedic pantheon, Indra, Varuna, everything is a psychological variable. This is how Sri Aurobindo approached. It's a very interesting approach. Based on Sri Aurobindo's insight, Sri Kapali Shastri, a celebrated disciple of Kavyagatta Ganapati Muni, wrote a very nice, wonderful commentary of Rig Veda, a very big commentary, Siddhanchana. In that commentary, he brings the concepts of various gods of the Rig Veda. What are they? Take for example Agni. Agni generally is ritual fire. This is the esoteric meaning of Agni. But in the esoteric sense, Agni is the divine will found in our heart. Vayu is vital, prana. Vayu is a wind in exoteric sense. And in exoteric sense, Vayu is prana. Varuna is an energy found in water. This is what we see Varuna. This is adibhautika, external. In external nature, what is Varuna? Energy found in water. In internal nature, Varuna is purity. Savita, Surya, Sun. But internally, Savita or Surya is Atman, Ushas. If Savita is Atman, if Surya is Atman, Surya's daughter Ushas, which is dawn in external world, internally she means the divine dawn, dawn of knowledge. Ashwins are the companions of Ushas or Savitri. Twins, this Ashwins, they are the two stars. Before the dawn of sun, these two stars are appearing in sky. This external meaning. Internally, Ashwins are the mastery power, mastery powers over vitals. In this way, all devatas are explained. Soma is Ananda. Soma is bliss. According to Sri Aurobindo and Kapali Shastri, almost all devatas are explained in this way in detail. Such kind of commentaries are there. So, all these commentaries are there before explanation, starting from the very Veda itself. And then, Yaska Nirupta, even in some places of Brahmanas, in some places of Upanishads, in some places of Ramayana and Mahabharata, we see this kind of esoteric explanation of Vedic mantras. Then Madhvacharya came, before that even, in the commentaries of Shankaracharya and Ramanujacharya, we see esoteric explanation in some context. Madhvacharya's Rigveda Bhashya itself is like that. Then, regarding, there are spiritual hints, spiritual explanation here and there, in Sayana or Skandaswami, and so on and so forth. Then in Bhakti tradition, we see how Bhakti is there in Rigveda. For that thesis is given by Bodhendral and Ayyavar, and a very long book, long explanation, that is Veda Vijnanam. Then we see how the epithets of God, epithets of various gods denote only one God. With this idea, Swami Dayanand wrote his commentary. Then came Sri Aurobindo, and following him Kapali Shastri. They all give detailed explanation of these gods, opening the door, showing us the esoteric, deeper meaning of these devatas. So this is the whole thing. These are all the great souls who contributed in this esoteric tradition. Tradition that sees the Rigveda or the whole of the Veda in esoteric way.
Wonderful. Wonderful, Dr. Raniji. Within a few minutes, you took us at least 7,500 years back from the age of Ramayana, and I think you have showered the entire lineage of commentators, the parampara of commentators in different eras and till date. So thank you for that, for recollecting all those great commentators. Therefore, it is becoming all the more interesting now to know what is the speciality of your commentary. We are very eager to know what is the speciality of your commentary now.
If already esoteric commentaries are existing, why to write this commentary? Why one more commentary? What is the need of this commentary? What is the uniqueness or speciality of this commentary? It's a nice question. I can say one thing. First of all, this commentary is exhaustive. Means every mantra is commented. The great Madhvacharya commented for 40 suttas, 40 chapters of Rigveda. 100 chapters Kapali Shastri touched. Many mantras Sri Aurobindo explained. Several mantras are taken from the Veda and deciphered by Bhakti traditions also. But yet, what I felt is that this spirituality is getting resonated throughout the text, starting from Agnimile Purohitam to Sangachadvam. Everywhere this spiritual insight is getting resonated. So why can't we write a commentary which can show the whole of Veda as a spiritual, esoteric, mystic text? So probably this is the first of its kind in Sanskrit language. That's one thing. That's the uniqueness of this. The second uniqueness, perhaps among the available Sanskrit commentaries of the Rigveda, this is the simplest one. Anybody with the Balapatam of Sanskrit, a little above Balapatam, can understand this commentary. This is another thing, this another speciality of this commentary. Third one I can say, perceiving all devatas as the indweller of devatas. Okay. Stutis of all devatas are only to denote the indweller, antaryami of all these devatas. This kind of approach can be found in Yaska, in the Gita, and in later commentaries like that of Dayanand Swami. Okay, fine. But it is Sri Aurobindo who started to give, in my knowledge, for the first time, the psychological meaning of these devatas. It is certain that all devata names are only for the ultimate divine. But still, as we have exoteric meaning for these gods, Agni means ritual fire, Vayu means wind, Savita means sun. This kind of animistic approach can be, animistic worship can be seen in the Rig Veda. But for every devata, there is an esoteric approach. This approach is brought by Sri Aurobindo, following him, Kapali Shastri, means Agni is the divine will, Vayu is vital. When this has got established, further this has to be explored. And this was my thought. If Kapali Shastri shows Agni as divine will, what is this divine will? If you talk on divine will, divine will and divine, what is the divine will? What does it mean? We have to approach Veda only to find out what is the divine will. That is, here the divine will is nothing but the will of universal welfare, will beyond egoistic clutches, will beyond the ahankara mamakara, will beyond the I-hood and mine-hood. Okay. In the same way, Vayu is prana, that's fine. Ashwins are masters of prana. What is this mastery over prana? Why they are twins? Why can't they be a single devata? Mastery, for mastery over prana, there can be a single god. Why they are twins? It's because this Ashwins, the twins, represent, in my perception, Suryanadi and Chandranadi. They are highly helpful for pranayama. They are nothing but pranayama. This inhalation exhalation process, through that we get mastery over prana. These two masteries, swasa praswasa masteries, they are Ashwins. Ushas, who is in between these two, like Subhadra is in between Krishna and Balarama in Puri Jagannatha. Ya Rakshita Raghava Lakshmana Bhyam, Sita is in between Rama and Lakshmana. The same way Ushas is in between Ashwins. If this swasa praswasa, inhalation exhalation masteries are Ashwins, then what can be Ushas? Naturally she is the Kumbhaka. Right? Now such a kind of approach to the Veda. In the exotic sense, yes, early morning before sun's dawn, there is Arunodaya. And that is Ushas. And at that time two stars are visible, they are Ashwins. That's fine. That is there. It's not rejected. But in esoteric sense, this Puraka, Rechaka and Kumbhaka, they are Ashwins and Ushas. That kind of approach. In the same way, if you take Indra, Sri Aurobindo calls Indra's mind power. But in my perception, Indra is strength. Physical strength, mental strength, this Indra, which can break the adjuncts like laziness and all, and uplift us, elevate us. Yes, exoterically, Indra is a thermal energy which breaks the blocks and make the water to flow. And we see rain everywhere. The same way, to bring our potential waters, Indra is breaking the blocks. The power which breaks the blocks here is Indra. That kind of approach is there. Indra represents strength. Then what? Varuna. Varuna in Kapali Shastri's commentary is purity. Here, Varuna is Rutam. Rutam literally means truth. But Rutam, its indicative meaning is cosmic order. And that is how most of us have accepted in yoga school of thought. Patanjali talks on Rutambara Samadhi. Rutambaratra Pragyana. There also Rutam is interpreted as cosmic order. So Varuna is the symbolic representation, or Varuna represents cosmic order. Soma, generally in exotic sense, it can represent moon, it also can represent the creeper which produces a tasty juice and healthy juice. But on the other hand, esoterically, Soma to Kapali Shastri is just a bliss. Here to us, Soma is rasa, aesthetic sense that flows in our life in all aspects of life, in a dharmic way. This elixir, this aesthetic sense is Soma. In this way, we explain so many things. So, I can say, having the psychological meanings found by our own previous commentators, taking them and exploring these gods, goddesses, symbols further, okay, for our spiritual sadhana, is the uniqueness of our commentary. This is the uniqueness of our commentary.
Very interesting, Trangaji. How are you deciphering that a particular devata is symbolic of a tattva or a concept?
A very interesting question. Even in the very beginning of our commentary, it is told, Vedena Vedaha Vigyayaha Hyatma Nyayaha Yatha Atmana. Veda should be known through Veda, like Atman can be understood by Atman. Atman cannot be recognized by objects. Atman cannot be recognized by the senses, even not through mind and intelligence. Atman can be actualized only by Atman. This is what Upanishad says. Nayam Atma Pravachanena Labhyaha Na Medhaya Na Bhuna Sutena Yam Eva Esha Vrunute Tena Labhyaha Tasesha Atma Vrunute Tanam Swam. So, as Atman has to be found by Atman, the Veda has to be found by the very Veda. If there is a riddle in Veda, to open the gate, okay, of that riddle, we have to search the solution in the very Veda itself. In some other context of the Veda, we have some insights which can demystify this riddle. That's how it goes. In this sense, if we call Agni as will, it is not our own thought. Agnirhijani kuryas chandaha. Agni is considered to be chandaha. Resolution, will. By the very Rigveda itself, what kind of chandas Agni is? Agnirhota kavikratuhu. A will of seer. Kratu means will. Kavi means seer. Okay. Seer means what? Everybody is a seer. Everybody has eye. They are seeing. Not that seer. One who sees beyond senses, beyond strong attachment and strong aversion. One who can see beyond his ego, he can be called a seer. Kavi means seer in the Veda. Kavi in ordinary sense is a poet. But ideal poet has to be a seer. This is what William Wordsworth says. Seeing into the life of the things, he says in Prelude. Seeing into the life of the things. So, seer. Kavikratuhu means will of seers. Agni is the will of seers. What will it can be? What will the seers can have? I hope that you have understood seer. Seer means the one who sees beyond his ego, beyond his ahankara, mamakara. What kind of will he can have? It's natural for a seer to have the will getting attuned to universal welfare. In that sense, Agni is the aspiration of universal welfare. Will of universal welfare. Will based on universal welfare. Says the Veda, Tamagne Yajnanam Hota Vishvesham Hitaha. Okay. Agni is nothing but the will, the passion, the burning wish of universal welfare. And our ritual fire represents that. Our ritual fire is a symbolic representation of that. That Agni, the will of universal welfare. So from the Veda itself we are quoting to decipher the esoteric meaning of devatas. Take for example Varuna. According to me, Varuna is the symbolic representation of cosmic order. He represents cosmic order. Everywhere he is associated with cosmic order. Prutena, Mitra, Varuna, Vrta, Vrdha, Vrtasprasa. Everywhere he is associated with Rutam. But there are some contests in the Rigveda in which Varuna and Rutam become synonymous. There we can find Varuna is Rutam. Brahma Trunoti Varunaha Gatu Vidam Tamimahe Vyurnoti Hrida Matim Navyo Jayatam Ritam Vittam Me Asya Rotasi. This is from first mandala of Rigveda. Here Brahma Trunoti Varunaha Navyo Jayatam Ritam. Here Varuna is something like Ritam is another name of Varuna or adjective of Varuna. Ritam literally means truth, but Ritam is traditionally taken to be cosmic order. That also has its place in Rigveda. Ritam niyatam ile, says Rigveda in 4th mandala. I see Indra as strength. On what basis I see Indra as strength? The Rigveda says in this way. Vishwanarasya vaspatim ananatasya shavasaha. In the Vedic language, Shavas means strength. Shavasaha Patim. Indra is the presiding deity of Shavas. The Rigveda says, presiding deity of strength. What kind of strength it is? Vishwanarasya Shavasaha Patim. Vishwanara means, Vishwanara means welfare to all humans, all human beings. Welfare to the whole humanity. That is called as Vishwanara. Vishwanarasya Shavasaha means strength which is for, which is used for the welfare of the whole world. Pati here is, Indra is the preceding deity of the strength which is for, which stands for the welfare of the whole world. Very clearly described here. And Indra's deeds, they are also symbolic in the Rig Veda. Cows are hidden in the mountain cave by some evil forces like Vritras, Valas, Panis, so on and so forth. Indra goes there and finds those cows, breaks that rock, enters into the cave and again revert these cows. This is how the Rig Veda describes. What are these cows? What are Vritras, Valas, Panis and Namchis? What are all these things? What Indra is doing here? If you ask this, the whole thing is symbolic. Gauhu means cow in Sanskrit. In Vedic language, Gauhu also means ray. Sun ray. Sun means soul, self. Sun ray means conscious rays. These conscious rays are our own potentials hidden here. They are all covered by adjuncts like Vritra, Vala, so on and so forth. Go to the etymological meaning of the word Vritra. Vyasa gives that meaning. Vritra means avarana, adjunct. The avavritram. It is also used as verb. In the same way, vala, vala samvarane, vala also means block. Namuchi, na mochayati, namuchihi. That's how Yaska says. Binding, namuchi means binding. Then what? Pani. Pani means materialist. Padam means money, wealth. Padi is materialistic attitude. One who is running after materialistic attitude. And then what? Padam means business mind, apana. Apana means shop, shopping, always seeing everything including spirituality in shopping sensation. Okay, that is pani. Then what? All this, dasyu. Dasyu means robber, thief, or robbing sensation. And these are all the enemies of Indra. Okay. Indra is fighting with all these evil forces. They have blocked these potentials within. And these potentials need not be always cow. Okay. To show these potentials are symbolic, I can quote few other mantras too. Take for example, in another mantra, elixir is bound by Vritras. Indra broke the rock and made the elixir to flow. Asnapinattam madhupariya pasyatu. In another mantra, truth is covered by untruth. Indra breaks untruth and makes the truth to flow. Rutavanaha pratichakshya amrutapunaha. What is this? In another context, splendor is covered by darkness. Brihaspatihi tamasi jyotihi chand. And these Vritras are not only, Vritras, plural. These Vritras are not only killed by Indra. Sometimes they can be killed by Brihaspati also, who is the presiding deity of intelligence. Sometimes spiritual aspirants can kill them. There are mantras where Angirasas killed Vritras. There are mantras which describe Soma killed Vritra. There is one mantra which says Soma is killing Vritra every day. That's how it, one mantra is there. All these things are showing us. Vritras or Valas are purely symbolic, and Indra is a motivating power which destroys, which demolishes these evil forces to bring out our potentials. And Indra's vehicle is carried by horses. What are these horses? In so many places in the Veda, the very Veda itself says horses are steeds. Vatan Hiswan Druyayu Jre, for example. Vatan Hi Aswan. In so many places, these horses are called as steeds. Even in English, they call us horsepower. In chariot, if you take Indra's chariot, it is again the symbolic representation of cosmic order, rhythm. You may ask, how do I know? The Veda says, Ko adhya yunte duriga rutasya. Instead of using the word ratasya, rutasya comes here. Tying the horses in rutam, says the Veda, suddenly. Instead of telling ratham. In many places, rutam is taken to be the chariot. And if you take Ashwins, I said they are the mastery powers of vitals. How can I tell that? They are always associated with Ushas. Madhav Pipanta Ushas Sachete. They are with Ushas and they enjoy the flowing rasa, flowing honey. Soma, this is what told here. What are these Ashwins? There is one sutta in the first mandala. 180th sutta. Jishnurva manyaha sumakasya surihi divo anyaha subhagav putra uhe. Prince. Almost in all other suttas, the twins are extolled together, that's all. Their adjectives are same. But this is a beautiful sutta where these two devatas, Ashwins, even among them, it shows some differentiation. Job of one and job of the other, it is talking about. There you can see, you can sense this, how they represent inhalation and exhalation, how they represent Suryanadi and Chandranadi. In these twins, one Ashwin's name is Surya, another one's name is Chandra, according to 181st Sukta of first mandala. Why one is called as Surya, why another one is called as Chandra? I see in this way, they are called as Surya and Chandra because one represents Surya Nadi, another one represents Chandra Nadi. One represents Surya Anudoma, another one represents Chandra Anudoma. It's a pranayama process. Swasa, praswasa, inhalation, exhalation process. There, through that, we get mastery of vitals. These are Ashwins and in between Ushas. Who else she can be? Other than Kumbhaka, stoppage of breaths. After all, Ushas in esoteric sense, everywhere, even according to Kapali Shastri, is Samadhi. Sun is Atman, Ushas is divine dawn, Savitri is divine dawn. This is a dawn just before sun's rise, Sarunodaya Kala. In esoteric sense, a Samadhi which comes to us just before Atma Sakshatkara, just before actualizing the self sun. And this is called as Kaivalya Prabhara in Patanjali. Anyhow, in higher layers of Samadhi, we need Kumbhaka. Without Kumbhaka, higher layers of Samadhi cannot occur. Samadhi is nothing but the stoppage of psychic modes. Okay. Yoga's definition and Samadhi's definition are one. Yoga ha chitta vritti dvodaha. Same definition can be taken for Samadhi too. It's because if you go to the etymological root of the word yoga, again it is yuj samadhu. Ultimately, yoga means samadhi. Yoga is equal to samadhi. It's stoppage of chitta vrittis. When the psychic modes are gradually getting controlled, getting stopped, With that, our vitals are also getting stopped. Hatha Yoga Pratipika says, Chalevate Chalam Chittam. So, our vitals are gradually getting settled down with our thought process. This is here yoga. Well, higher level of samadhi, naturally the breath is slowed and naturally the breath is getting stopped. Going to go to samadhi, even in kriyas we can see this. Take for example Kapalabhati. After the practice of Kapalabhati, there is a natural stoppage of breath we are experiencing every day. It's a very normal thing. If it can happen in Kapalabhati, why not in higher level of samadhi? Therefore, if Ushas is samadhi, she is Kumbhaka too. While Ashwins are inhalation, exhalation, masteries, mastery powers of prana. In this way, based on the 181st Sutta of the first mandala of Rigveda, we have explained. Bujjim amhasaha viprataha nirashvina. And there is a very nice thing in Rigveda. That is, Bujju was guarded by Ashwins. Bujju fell. Bujju was drowning in the ocean. Ashwins are good sailors. They brought the boat and they guarded Bujju. What is this Bujju? What is this ocean? And how Ashwins are guarding this Bujju? Bujju is a businessman who is traveling far away and Ashwins guarded them. Those are all fine. Maybe historically true also. I don't know. But we can easily decipher this to be symbolic. In the 10th mandala, 65th sutta, suddenly Rigveda says, everywhere Rigveda says, Ashwins are uplifting Bujju from ocean, Bujju from water. What kind of expression is that? Here it is told, Bujju is uplifted from evil. Bujjim amhasaha abhibhutaha. In another place also, Tena Bhadrena Sharmana Yushmatam Nava Vasavaha Ati Viswani Durita Vipartana. The one who is drowning in Durita, he was uplifted by the divinity coming in boat. What is this? This nothing but a boat is this ocean, this water is psychological only. Our own vasanas. Our own psychic imprints. This is the ocean. Amtasya mudre hridyantarayushi. Hrida samudrena. Amtasya mudre hridi. Samudra in Rigveda is this. There Ashwins are sailing. They are good sailors. What they do in this vasanamaya mind. This guy in the samsara is here. Kama, krodha, lobha, moha. In this vasanamaya samsara, this guy is drowning. This Bujju is drowning. Bujju means bhokta. Enjoyer is drowning. Ashwins are prana masteries, mastery powers. They are uplifting this guy who is falling. So for that, clear indication is given here. Ano nava matinam yatam paraya gantave injatam asvinaratam. To transcend the mind, O Ashwins, you bring your chariot. So understood this. Water as mind. And these Ashwins are very great healers too. Why healers? Pranayama is a healing process. Healing thing or therapy, yoga therapy is not modern for your information. Many people are thinking like that. Once yoga was not for healing, only now Westerners' contribution it is that they brought yoga to healing or therapy. No. Yoga therapy is something different. It's not modern. Even long before Shvetashvatara Upanishad, says natasya rogaha Praptasya yogagnimayam shariram. Roga cannot be found in the one who has yoga fire in his body. Okay. Take Hatha Yoga Pradipika. In every asana, as a result, it shows how body becomes healthy, how diseases are eradicated. It's not new. And that is why Ashwins are here healers. That is why Rudra is a great healer. Because Rudra also is a symbolic representation of Samveda in my perception. The acceleration, yet a disciplined acceleration. Acceleration can be experienced everywhere in the cosmos. Without acceleration, nothing is there. Acceleration and destruction. Destruction is not negative. So many things are getting destructed, that is why the positive spirit is built in the world. What is that? If winter comes, I hope that you know. Anybody of you? If winter comes, we have to think that spring is yet to come after winter. Such a kind of expression is there. After storm?
Calm before the storm.
Calm before the storm. Calm after the
calm.
Yeah, the storm. That's a consolation. That's how we get. It's not just consolation, but it has a meaning. If again orderliness has to be established, a destruction happens in nature. Unless the already existing cells are getting destroyed or going outside, new cells cannot exist here in the body. Body cannot remain healthy. Everywhere it is like that. Unless the manifest nature again enters into unmanifest nature, unless the chaos is created, this pralaya, unless it comes, again the recycling cannot be accomplished. Pralaya is for recycling. And the acceleration, the disciplined acceleration which makes this recycling process, that is Rudra. That is why Puranas call him as Sanghara Devata. And this Rudra becomes a great healer. Because Vega may not be a good healing. Okay. Vega may not be, speed may not be used for healing. But Samvega, speed may cause disease. But Samvega of Patanjali, Tivra Samveganam Asamnaha, Samvega of Patanjali, Yoga Shastra, a disciplined speed, that heals us. That is why Rudra is Vaidyanatha. Yo Vishwasya Chayati Veshajasya. Okay, he has all medicines. He is a very great healer. All these things are there. By the way, Ashwins are highly connected to this great God Rudra. Ayatam Rudra Vartani, says the Rig Veda. In Ramayana, Bhalakanda, there is a shloka. Sthanum Devam Iva Achintyam Kumara Viva Pavaki. Ashwins follow the course of Rudra, says Balaganda. Here also, Ayatam Rudravartani. Ashwins follow the course of Rudra. Okay. We see here, for all these things, abundantly mantras are available. These are not our own imagination. Mantra shows us what is the esoteric sense of this devata. The mantra reveals all these things to us. In this way only we find what is Brihaspati or what is Indra, what is Vayu, what is Aditi, what is Saraswati, all these things. Moreover, another uniqueness regarding our Vedic commentary is many riddles found in the Veda are demystified. Knots are solved, knots are opened. There are many riddles because the Rig Veda is a mystic literature. Many riddles are there, only spiritual aspirants can understand. For them, for the sadhakas, so many things are given. These riddles, let me give an example. Agni had several elder brothers. They tried to carry oblations to devatas from humans. But being incapable of carrying oblations, they all died. Agni only survived. This comes in Rigveda, 10th mandala. What is this? What are these brothers? Well, definitely on listening to the story, we certainly understand this is symbolic. It has some other truth behind it. What's that? We have already established Agni is the aspiration of universal welfare. Burning wish of universal welfare. Okay. Only through this we communicate to the divinities. Divinity is hidden here. Indra is hidden here. Indra is strength. Vayu is vital. Varuna is cosmic order. Mitra is love. Devotion. All these devatas are hidden here. If these devatas have to be invoked in our internal yajna, Agni is helpful. Agni is the aspiration of universal welfare. Only through him we can communicate to devatas. And the oblations which we offer here, in exotic sense, we offer oblations to the ritual fire. Internally, these oblations are nothing but thoughts which we are offering to the aspiration of universal welfare. The actions are sticks here. Actions and the thoughts attuned to the aspiration of universal welfare, they are the havis, they are the oblations. Who can carry this kind of oblation? Only the passion of universal welfare, aspiration of universal welfare. Who are his elder brothers? Aspiration to one's own family, wishing of the welfare of one's own family, wishing of the welfare of one's own egoistic bondage, wishing of the welfare of one's own society, one's own clan, one's own creed, one's own caste, one's own language. All these things are elder brothers of. Because through the gradual evolution only, finally, the aspiration to universal welfare dawns. When the aspiration to universal welfare dawns, it becomes capable of carrying the thought and action oblation to the divinities. And these divinities are invoked. All other kinds of aspiration, all other kinds of wishes die. Finally, after the destruction of all these kinds of wishes, the final wish of the universal welfare, the dance which take the oblations from the mortals to devatas. And that is how this riddle is explained here in my commentary. Next riddle, let me take Yama Yami, another riddle. Conversation of Yama and Yami. Who is Yama and who is Yami? Yami is tempting Yama. Yami is suggesting Yama to do evil things. Yama is refusing. This conversation goes. What is this Yama? What is that Yami? Is it Lord Yama? Yes, this is Lord Yama. Because from the next sutta onwards, Lord Yama is extolled. Okay, for next around 10 suttas, Lord Yama is extolled. So same Lord Yama is here Yama. And there is one Yami. What is this Yami? What is that Yama? And who is Lord Yama? Yama is restrained. Yama is to restrain. Yama is restrainer. Restraining power of mind. In Yoga Shastra, we call as Yama and Niyama. That same Yama is this Lord Yama. This. The same Yama. Here the same Yama, this Lord Yama represents Yama and Niyama. Discipline, the instinct to discipline us from the evil forces, that is Yama. And the tempting mind, which always henpeck to do evil things, that is Yami. Their conversation comes here. So Yami always, this is war, quarrel is going on in mind. In Freudian language, one has to be called as id, another one has to be called as superego. About EB conversation, I see as the conversation of id and superego. Okay, id means it's a pressure principle. I have to pinch somebody. Now it is power cut. Therefore, nobody will see me. A small boy sitting here, I have to pinch him. That kind of tendency comes. Okay. But another mind says, no, don't do that. That is wrong. This is superego. Okay, it turned to superego. There are clashes happening here always. This is found in a beautiful conversation of Yama and the Yama. Sorry, Yama and Yami. They are brother and sister. They converse in this way. That is how the conversation of Yama and Niyama is taken by us. Urvashi and Pururava's conversation in Rigveda's 10th mandala. That also is demystified by us in the esoteric sense. This conversation is perceived. So many things. There is a very famous Dasharajna war in the Rigveda. War of 10 kings. The word Rajan is taken and translated as king. Then war of 10 kings. Dasharajanaha. Who are they? No, what are they? Who are these 10 kings? Historians are celebrating this war. Even long before Mahabharata war, a huge war is recorded in Rigvedic literature. There must be some huge war happening long, long before Mahabharata, where 10 kings participated. Who are they? They must be the kings of Angadesha, Kosala Desha, Gandhara Desha, Kekaya Desha. What must be those Desha's emperors who must have participated in the war? For information, no Desha's name is mentioned in Rigveda Samhita. No country's name is mentioned. No region's name is mentioned in Rigveda Samhita. Emperors of these Deshas, even the very Desha's names are not coming there. How can you take them as emperors? Who are they? Historically, such kings might have fought. I don't know. I don't deny. I neither deny nor accept it. That is not my job. Who are they? That's not my job. But regarding this 10 king war found in the Veda, why can't we decipher the Veda itself? Instead of imagining, are they Anga king or Vanga king? Or, instead of imagining this way, why can't we decipher in the Veda itself? Well, the Veda is talking about 10 Rajans. 10 Rajans, it says everywhere. Not everywhere. In 2 or 3 contests, this Dasha Rajan war is coming. There it says Rajan, but in one place, interestingly, in Dasha Rajan war, it says Itkarave Dasha Vrutrani Aprati Barishmate Ni Sahasrani Vargayaha. Here it is not calling Dasha Rajans as Dasha Rajans, Dasha Vrutras, 10 Vrutras. And then 1000 Vrutras, Ni Sahasrani Vargayaha. What are these 10 Vrutras and 1000 Vrutras? These Rajans are called as Vrutras here. Why? So they may not be kings, they must be Vrutras. Vrutra means adjunct, Vrutram is avarnam. In many places in the Veda, Vrutram is in neutral gender, for your information. And in plural, Indra Vrutrani, neutral. And plural, Indra Vrutrani Janganat. Here also, Dasha Vrutrani, Aprati Varishmate Nisahasrani Varhaya. 10 adjuncts, what can be there? The Veda is not clear regarding this, but we can easily decipher these 10 adjuncts to be 10 senses. Anyhow, Taittiriya Aranyaka talks about 10 senses. And these tenses, these indriyas, which are named as indriyas in Taittiriya, Aranyaka or later Shastras, could have been called as Vritras in Rigveda. What is wrong in it? If you cannot interpret Dasa Vritras as Dasa Indriyas, then how are you going to interpret this? That is why I interpreted Dasa Vritras as Dasa Indriyas. And there further streams, subdivisions can be called as 1000 Vritras. Indra destroyed 10 Vritras and 1000 Vritras. This mantra comes in Dasarajna Varu only. Therefore, definitely Rajan is here replaced with Vritra. Okay. Clearly indicating Rajans are Vritras. Then why are they called as Rajans? Why are they kings? These senses are kings. You need not take the meaning of king for Rajan at all. You can go to the root meaning. Rajanu Deeptav. Shining ones. Generally senses in Samhita are called as shining ones. Nainat Devaha Apnavan Purvamarshat in Shukla Yajurveda. That Deva means sense. This is what Shankara Bhagavata has commented. Devas here, senses. Okay. Because Deva means shining one, that is his senses. So here also, Rajan means shine. Rajanu Deeptav. Rajan is the one who is gladdening you, Ranjaka. Therefore, Rajan. These senses are gladdening us. Therefore, senses are called as Rajans. This is how I approach this. So many riddles. Vrishakapi riddle, Urvashi riddle, and Dasha Rajan Bar riddle, and Indra Aditi conversation, that riddle. All these riddles are demystified here in our commentary. This is another unique thing here. Exhaustively riddles are demystified. That's a unique thing. Fourth unique thing, or fifth one, I think. First one is the whole Rigveda is commented. Second one is this is the simplest commentary among available all commentaries. Third one, innovative in approaching the symbols, deciphering the symbols in a deeper sense, even though these symbols are explained in by previous commentators. Taking this, their decipher, their exploration further. That's the third one. Fourth one, exhaustively riddles are demystified without any interesting. Because I am very careful regarding this. In the excitement of demystifying the things in the Veda, we should not deviate from the heart of the Mother Veda. It's very important. We should not go against the heart of the Mother Veda. The most important thing is to guard the heart of the Veda. Okay. As an excitement we have to show our scholarship, we can't take the Vedic purport in a different direction. So, based on the Veda, Vedena Vedo Vijnayaha, based on the Vedic words, deciphering the Vedic words, we demystify the riddles. And the fifth one, last but not the least, that is, this commentary, when I finished this commentary, I strongly felt this commentary has to be acknowledged by the traditionalists, because it is the traditionalists who are guarding the Veda time immemorial. No doubt in it. They have the disciplines to guard the Veda, and meticulously and zealously they are guarding the Veda without any alteration and adulteration. So, I felt that the great traditionalists have to accept this kind of esoteric sense of the Veda which I have presented. They have to acknowledge. So, it should not be seen as against tradition. That is my feeling. So for that I approached various traditional mathas. Very old mathas they are. And their pontiffs, because we need the blessing of them. Please give your thought, your opinion regarding this commentary. I requested them. They all wholeheartedly participated. They happily gave their thought regarding this commentary. And with all those thoughts only, we are publishing this book. With their acknowledgement and with their appreciation, this commentary is getting published. And these insights, not only with the traditional monks, traditional scholars, our contemporary Vedic scholars, traditional scholars who read the Veda with Sayana Bhashya or Bhaskaracharya's Bhashya, such kind of great souls, they also have blessed and they also had given their preface, their thought, their opinion regarding my commentary. And I sought the humble, in a humble way, their thought, their suggestion regarding this commentary. And fortunately, we got that, their thoughts. And in this way, our commentary is traditional. These are the five things in which our esoteric commentary is, I feel this as special.
Very, very interesting set of thoughts, Ramji. So I was reminded of one of the unique features which you had mentioned exactly a year ago when we were discussing about the Ramayana work. It was particularly to stick to the original heart of Valmiki, not to deviate from the heart of Valmiki. And here you have again reinforced that for the Vedic commentary, not to deviate from the original heart of Veda, to be true to the heart of Veda. So a very exceptional line of thinking. One last question, Ranjanji. Very curious to know why you have named this book Dhvani Deepika.
Dhvani. Dhvani means tone. Even in English literature they talk on tone. Nowadays, previously it was not that. In my knowledge, T.S. Eliot brought this. Before that, it was not there. My guess is that it must have gone from India. We long ago talked on this tone. Tone of a literature is very important while we research on a particular literature. Kavyasya Atma, tone is the soul of a kavya, says Anandavardhana, the author of Dunyaloka. Dunyaloka is a text of literary criticism. Only to explain what is tone, how to decipher tone. There are literary works which are devoid of tone, which have no tone at all. Such kind of literary works are not sublime, says Anandavardhana. We can understand a literature to be more sublime on seeing the depth of tone of that literary text. A literature may have alankaras, figures of speech, may have onomatopoeia, may have so many things, pun, oxymoron, so on and so forth. Yet, if that literature doesn't have tone, that literature is not great, according to Anandavardhana. On the other hand, if your literary text has tone in it, if it doesn't have any other thing like figure of speech and chandas, vrittam, yet that literature is a celebrated one. It has to be celebrated, he says. In that sense, if tone is important in a literature, if a literature has to be called as great only because of its tone, then perhaps, in my knowledge, the Veda, here the Veda, I include Rig Veda, Yajur Veda and Sama Veda, all these Vedas, not only Rig Veda, the Vedic literature is the best, is excellent, among the tome literary works, tome based literary works. A tome is everywhere found in the Veda. Vedic deities are archetypal. Several layers of meaning we have for the Vedic deities. If we contemplate or meditate on these deities and mantras, these deities and mantras are unfolding layer after layer, like lotus blossoms, petal by petal. That we see throughout the Veda. And this tone based literature we have, the Rig Veda. And that is why this commentary's objective is to explore the tone of Rig Veda. And that is why this commentary is named as Dhoni Deepika. Dhoni Deepika. Deepika is illumining. Illumining the tone. That's the meaning, name of this Grantha, this text. And one more thing. Any other question? Okay. This book, Dhoni Deepika, is a very huge literature which runs for some 3,400 pages around, and has 10 volumes. That too, the whole of literature is in Sanskrit. The whole of commentary is in Sanskrit. Therefore, another one more small book is getting published, which runs only for 200 pages. The Veda, My Passion. Book's title is The Veda, My Passion. This book becomes the essence of that huge magnum opus, the Vedic commentary. So, this book also, this small book, which is the essence of the Vedic commentary, also is going to get published.
Excellent, excellent to know that, Dr. Ranganji. I think over the last hour or so, I mean, you have also unraveled multiple layers and tones. I think we have also been in Dunya Loka of Devas, so to say. We have been enjoying the different layers of the archetypes of Devas. Thanks for that. And our sincere gratitude and thanks to you for elaborately and very simplistically explaining the fundamental features and unique features of Dhoni Deepika, the upcoming commentary of the Rig Veda. And we are also very excited to know that there is also a short English concise version of it, which is more like a synopsis of the Dhvani and the commentary of Rig Veda. We are sure that all the students of Vedic disciplines, they will be greatly thrilled to have this commentary with them. And as the name suggests, it is Dhvani Deepika, so I am sure there is light in it, there is sound in it. Both sound and light are coming together, and I am sure it's going to enlighten the hearts and minds of all the people who are interested in Vedic literature. Once again, please accept our heartfelt gratitude, and we are all very eagerly awaiting for 27th January 2021, and that's the day when this magnum opus, a 10 volume commentary of the Rig Veda, is going to be released, authored by Dr. Ranganji, published by Vibolim, and through the hands of the Honorable Krishna Premi Swamigal, and we are all eagerly awaiting for it. Jai Sita.